Beau Harris was a plump, perfectly formed baby. But he never cried. He never even took a breath. Beau was just a few weeks from being born when he was robbed of his life by a careless driver. In fact, robbed of any rights. The driver? Well, he walked free. As Janet McIntyre reports, Beau's family is now fighting for a law change.
You gotta squeeze it really hard.
The cake and Smarties are here. There's a birthday to celebrate.
You want to decorate some for your baby brother?
But someone is missing.
Wait, does he have a grave?
Kind of. He was someone. And he had a place in our family. And he should have been here.
Baby Beau, the fifth little Harris boy.
He's chubby and, you know, he's got little eyebrows and fingers and toes.
But Beau Harris was not a person, not a human being under New Zealand law. He came and he went in this world with barely a trace.
Our baby needs to be recognised as being a baby, a living person with a future that has been taken from him and taken from us.
State Highway 1 snakes through the steep Dome Valley north of Auckland and is one of the deadliest stretches in the country.
There have been 40 deaths in the past 20 years between Warkworth and Wellsford. And it's here Beau Harris was killed by a careless driver. But his death was not counted because Beau was never officially alive. And under New Zealand law, the careless driver could not be held responsible.
It's like a kick in the teeth. There's just no justification for losing him.
Joanna Harris, heavily pregnant with her fifth son, had just finished her cleaning job on a Friday afternoon. She was due to give birth in 6 weeks, or maybe sooner.
I was pretty big, yeah. I was hanging out there. I wouldn't have been surprised if he came early because I was so active.
Just after four, her mum, Marianne, a truck driver, was also finishing up for the weekend.
It was about time for Joanna to be picking the boys up from school, so I knew she would be in the Dome.
It was wet. Joanna, with a workmate passenger, was driving north to Wellsford.
Thinking of what we're going to have for dinner when we get home.
When, just past the top of the Dome and around a corner, a van appeared in her lane.
It was just a flash. It just turned and all of a sudden I could just see the front of him coming straight towards me.
What were you thinking?
How do I avoid it? You know, if I brake, will I miss him? I can't go left. There was a bank and I couldn't go right because there was a huge line of traffic. And so I just put my arm up and I held the steering wheel and I just started to take my feet off the accelerator. And
she couldn't do anything.
Gabrielle Crowe, two cars back from the van that was about to hit Joanna, had a clear view.
His car suddenly moved to the right-hand side. It didn't look like he had swerved or slid. It was more so that he'd lost control somehow and just shot off to the side.
Just waited for him to hit us.
You knew it was going to happen.
Couldn't avoid it. There was nowhere to go.
There was no chance of escape, and the cars exploded. She was groaning. She was in pain. And the first thing she said was, "I'm pregnant. My baby, I'm pregnant."
Gabrielle was first to reach the mangled wreck where Joanna was trapped.
All I could see was impact on her legs. Her arm had been severed as well as bleeding from her head, but I knew that there would be internal damage.
Despite life-threatening injuries, Joanna stayed conscious and focused.
We were trying to think, why don't I go into labour? Can I push this baby out?
Did you try?
I tried. It didn't work though.
What did you think
her fate would be when you left?
I thought it would be likely that she would not survive.
Marianne was herself heading towards the dome and saw a sign about an incident.
And I've heard the sirens go so many times, but I've never had this feeling. I knew it was her. I just knew in my heart.
By the time Marianne reached her only daughter at Auckland Hospital, Joanna was in critical condition, and so was the baby.
It was a very slim chance because he had a detached placenta, so he hadn't had any oxygen, no blood circulation.
Outside in the waiting room, Marianne knitted a blanket for her grandson, not realising he was already cold.
We didn't hear anything till 11 o'clock we sat there till.
Then news from a doctor.
He just said we'd lost the baby and that we're nearly losing Joanna. And that's all I could say. We're trying.
Joanna remained in an induced coma with multiple serious injuries for almost a month.
We never left her.
And woke to see photos of the baby boy she never held.
He was perfect. He had no injuries. And there was no bruising, no broken bones. She never got to breathe.
At 34 weeks, Beau was a perfectly viable baby. And if he'd been born alive, even if he'd taken a single breath, legally, he would have been a person, a human being with rights. But because he was dead when he was taken from Joanna's womb, it's almost like he never existed.
Coming up, the driver who caused the crash.
Do you accept it was your fault?
I'm really, really sorry about this crash, you know, but I don't think it's my fault.
Is it time for a change to protect the unborn child?
Should we change the law?
Well, I think the law should be tested.
With 16 broken bones and multiple internal injuries, doctors have told Joanna she was lucky to survive.
They say I'm a miracle.
Unable to work for the past 3 years, she is slowly regaining function in the arm, which she almost lost in the crash.
My arm was shattered in between my elbow and my wrist and my elbow and my shoulder. So it's literally just that little piece of skin there that was keeping my arm attached.
But she's yet to heal from the loss of her fifth son, Beau, the brother of Jacob, Caleb, Robbie and Connor. Beau would now be almost three.
Be playing ball with his brothers, running around the house, causing havoc.
If he hadn't been killed in Joanna's womb by a careless driver.
Hello, Liang, it's Janet McIntyre here from TVNZ.
TVNZ?
Yes. Hi.
Hello.
The driver of the van that caused the crash, Auckland businessman Liang Lu, has not reached out to Joanna. He declined to make a formal statement to police, saying only he lost control.
Why did you lose control?
I don't know. It's raining, very, very heavy raining.
It's raining, right.
Yeah.
Do you accept it was your fault?
I'm really, really sorry about this crash, you know, but I don't think it's my fault.
You don't think it's your fault?
Sorry. Oh. I think that our conversation is over, okay? Okay, sorry about that. I have no idea about this.
A police investigation found Liang was speeding in the wet conditions, lost control on a bend, and crossed the centre line. In court, he pleaded guilty to 3 counts of careless driving causing injury.
On the court, I said I'm guilty. It's just because she lost her baby.
Oh, I see.
I just want to quick finish it.
I'm wondering why you didn't try to approach the woman driver.
Because police told me don't need to touch this woman, right?
Don't need to reach out to her, right?
Yeah, don't need, because she said ACC will cover everything.
Liang Lu was ordered to pay reparation of $9,000 to Joanna and was disqualified from driving for 7 months. He was not charged in relation to the death of Bo. Under current law, Bo was not a victim.
A child has no rights until they're born alive, and at that point they become a person in the eyes of the law.
It's important to understand...
Law Professor Nicola Peart of Otago University, an expert in medical law, says the so-called born-alive rule is one we adopted from Britain when we were colonised.
The law in England had been in existence since about 1600, so it's a very old law. Not really moved with the times in some respects.
Most reasonable people looking at this particular case couldn't help but feel it's unfair that there was no accountability for this child.
Yep. And I have every sympathy with that. I mean, I think most people do feel very uncomfortable about it. And it is perhaps worth seeing whether or not Parliament is interested in changing the law to meet this particular need and to recognise it.
The New South Wales government has this month committed to making such a law change. 10 years after Sydney mother Brodie Donegan was struck by a drug-affected driver and lost her unborn daughter Zoe at 32 weeks.
Whole piece of legislation is anti-choice legislation, abortion.
But it's controversial. It's been resisted by women's rights groups, who believe that any law that makes it an offence to kill an unborn child will impact on women's access to abortion.
It's always so difficult. Where do you draw the line? How do you protect the unborn child without sacrificing the mother's rights?
Why can't we have a law that relates to a third party killing an unborn child?
Well, we can. Of course we can. Parliament can make whatever law it likes.
Should we change the law?
Well, I think the law should be tested. I think it is perhaps time to see whether the current law is essentially too strict on the born alive rule. But I think it's going to be really difficult to frame legislation that does not interfere with the rights and freedoms of the pregnant woman.
For Joanna and her mum Marianne, it's simple. They want unborn children like Bo, killed in traffic accidents, to be acknowledged as people, and for manslaughter charges to apply to those at fault.
He was someone. He was a life.
It's a living person who has a future, who is a value to the world, who is a value to their family, could be a doctor, could be a lawyer, could be a labourer. Who cares? But that child had a future and value.
Yes, he did. Joanna has started a petition hoping for a law change in New Zealand. So far, she has almost 3,000 signatures. The New South Wales Attorney General has told Sunday the government will honour its commitment to changing their laws.